much for being here tonight. It is so exciting for me to know that there are so many people in Janesville that are as excited about this as I am. And gee, who would have thought we'd be interested in beer?
Yeah, go figure.
We're in Wisconsin. But this is so cool. I am a huge history buff, and I think this project is really amazing. And I hope that you guys all learn something tonight like I did yesterday when he was showing me his presentation. Just so much information and an exciting project that he has undertaken. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Rob Bier.
Thank you. I'd like to start off by thanking Renee and the library for having me here. It was back in May when I first approached them about this project. And I, as I'll explain, I live actually in Maryland. So it took some time to go ahead and get this arranged. But I'm very happy to see so many people in the audience. And I look forward to this very much. The presentation is about an hour and a half. There's a lot of graphics in there. But I'll keep it moving at a pretty good clip. When you do PowerPoint presentations, there's really four rules you have to follow. You know, the first one is make sure you have a good color palette so people can see what's on the slide. The second one is to make sure that you don't have too many words on the slide so people aren't reading the slide when you're trying to talk. The third one, and this is from the presenter's perspective, is you don't read the slide because that's very annoying as well. And the last thing, of course, is you want to make it as interesting as possible aesthetically. So there's, again, a lot of pictures on that, and hopefully that'll come through here in the presentation. There's really three goals that I have with this presentation. The first one, and I hope to achieve the first one, is just to share something that I've learned about the city of Janesville with you so you can leave saying, hey, I learned this. I didn't know this was the part of Janesville's history before. The second one, obviously, is to get an appreciation for Janesville's beer brewing history, because it's one of these things that the more, when you start pulling the string on the research, the further you pull it, the more you find. And I was just amazed at how deep this industry was in Janesville up until Prohibition. And the last thing is really in the title. It's called Hidden History because growing up in Janesville, whenever I'd be walking around downtown, you look at a lot of the buildings and a lot of the places, and sometimes you just take them for granted, and you don't really understand all the history that's associated with them. And really, in the case of one of the breweries here that's going to be behind Mercy Hospital, it is really truly hidden behind all these trees and overgrown vegetation. But the history's there. So if you can take a minute just to try to, you know, when you see something, look a little deeper, you'll find out more about it. And more times than not, it's extremely interesting. So really quick, I will be here after the presentation if you want to come up and share anything you have with me. I also have some business cards in back. I do have a Facebook site that is taking the place, really, of the webpage, which I hope to kick off next July. If you have any questions at any time during the presentation, just please raise your hand and ask. It's better to stop me when I'm going as it is to, rather than waiting till the very end, because I guarantee you I won't remember. I'm getting old. And with that, I'll go ahead and kick off. I've organized the presentation into four sections. First one is a little bit about the project we're working on. Second one, we'll be looking at the breweries themselves, and up to 16 of them so far, but I'm convinced there's more of them out there. Then we'll talk about the next steps, where we'd like the effort to go, and then make a kind of a sales pitch for all the other interesting industries that were in Janesville that offer a fascinating history that perhaps someone else could look at. All right, this first photo, I had the privilege of meeting with Mike Knipp last May. He recently passed, and he was able to share a family photo. This is from the brewery that's just behind Mercy Hospital. It had several different owners, but under Lewis Knipp, it was called the City Brewery. And this is the only picture I've been able to find where you actually have the brewers in front of the brewery posing for a photo. And you can see right away, there's only a handful of employees there. There's not a lot. Most breweries only operated with about 10 to 12 people at the most. So here's kind of the mission statement of what I'm trying to do. The bottom line is this started off as a personal interest research project. I had to call it something, and the Janesville Brewery Research Project sounded a lot better than Rob Bier's research project, so I just created that. And the goal is really to document as much information as I can find, capture as many of the artifacts that are out there, provide the context behind them, and then share them. I know people ask a lot, do you have a big collection as far as research, collecting for items? I collect some things, But I've been very fortunate over the last year and a half that people will share them with me, and I can take pictures of them and be able to put them on the webpage so that way everyone can see them. Anything that I do have in the collection that I have, it's all going to be given away at the end of the day. Because, you know, again, I'm in Southern Maryland. It doesn't do much good there. I want to make sure that, you know, the Historical Society and the library and others can share it with them as well. So the effort, it's really a three-prong effort. Part of it is researching Janesville's history, how to brew beer, because it's quite different today than it was back in the 1800s, very different. And the third thing is trying to track down family members to get their story. Because once Prohibition hit, a lot of the brewing stopped. And only two other breweries opened up afterwards. And it's trying to find out where the people went once it closed. So I do a number, I conduct research a number of ways. A lot of it's on the internet, obviously, because I'm in Maryland. But when I get the opportunity to meet with people, I do. I'm able to record a lot of the conversations and then go back and flesh out the details. But I will offer this as an alibi up front. I'll talk about my biography in a second. But I only lived in Janesville until I was about 13 or 14. Then I went to Milwaukee, then I came back again. So my knowledge of Janesville's history is very limited. So if you see something that if it's factually incorrect, that it is a bit more than just a one-off, you know, don't be afraid to correct me. All I would ask is just, you know, be polite about it. Say, hey, you clown, you know, you're wrong here. Because I do the best I can, and I use a number of different sources to try to get that. A lot of these sources, I'm sure people are familiar with. The Growing Up in Janesville Facebook page is a huge help, because every now and again I run across a photo that I don't know where it was taken. And if I ask a question, someone will go ahead and answer it. A lot of the organizations, when I come back to visit, I'm always in the library and the Historical Society, always running around asking questions about trying to find information, to research it. I had a very fortunate meeting with Dennis from the Ice Age Trail. I just happened to be walking back by the Northside Brewery behind Mercy Hospital on, I think it was a Thursday or Friday. And he said, hey, we're trying to clean up this brewery here. And I would get very excited. I was like, this is great, because even though it's back there and it's been overgrown, if you look at it, what it could be so much more, to be an integral part. You could actually make it a small little area where people could actually stop when they're actually exercising by there, as opposed to running away from it as quickly as they can. The Wisconsin Advertising and Antique Club, you know, when I started this, I knew nothing about beer bottles and trying to date them and research for the brewing industry. But I joined this club online, and they're out of Milwaukee, and these are some of the most fascinating people. We actually did a dugout, a privy there, I think it was on Franklin Street. There's gentlemen that collect everything beer. And some of these guys go way back into the 50s and 60s and 70s, and they're walking encyclopedias. So it's only because these gentlemen here are willing to share their information with me that I'm able to bring it back and localize it to Janesville. And of course, the Beer Can Collectors of America. Collecting beer cans was a big thing in the 70s when I was a kid. I think it's kind of died out with these computers. Just a little bit about me. I was born in, again, Lowry's Garage in Janesville. I was pretty much in this area over here, although I did meander quite a bit across the river here. This is where the Croaks Brewery would be, the one on the north side. Joined the Air Force, did 21 years there. Then I retired and started working for the Department of Homeland Security. I've been there for 11 years and got another 11 years to go before I retire. And I can do this full time. And I got a couple of degrees, so at least on paper, I guess I'm smart. Now, when you start researching something like this, it can get very confusing very quickly, because you have to define first what is a brewery, and I've got the definition of what it is there. And then every time a brewery changes hands, it's not a new brewery, it's just someone else is owning it and they may call it something different. So trying to deconflict all this can be a problem. So what I do is essentially each brewery has a number. If the brewery is burned down, it gets a new number. And if it changes hands, it gets a ABC or D type designator. So that's for the to keep everything so if wherever talking about a brewery, I can quickly identify which one it is we're talking about. Because several breweries were called several different names, and it gets very, very confusing. Now, before I jump in and start going right to the breweries, there's a couple things, I call these detours, that try to put this into context. And I know in today's age where we have our smartphones and computers and we have so much at our fingertips, that it's hard to imagine what life was back in the mid-1800s. And breweries were a critical element within a social element of the town. You know, one of the smartest guys in the town would be the bartender, because he knew everybody that would come in there. And they were they were the social place that men would go to hang out. And both of these photos here are from bars in Wisconsin. One of them is on Milwaukee Street, the other is on Main. And working in a brewery was extremely challenging. People were routinely hurt, if not killed. And I have a couple of articles here that talk about it. One of them is just a pail of shellac explodes, and somebody gets burned. The next one, you have a beer vat that explodes. Fortunately, nobody was injured. But even when you're delivering the beer in the kegs, horses would run astray in the wagons, and there'd be collisions, and people would frequently die. But when you think of actually the brewing process, everything had to be loaded and unloaded by hand. And the brewing was very smelly, long days, and you know, reasonable pay, but there weren't a lot of benefits back then. So to say it was a challenging experience would be really an understatement. But the breweries themselves, because there were so many of them, they were an economic driver as well. Because to have a brewery, you have to have a building, you got to build it, you got to have employees, you got to have horses to be able to deliver the beer, you have to be able to feed the horses, and you have to have the saloons and liquor stores upon which to sell it. And of course, for the government, they get their taxes out of it. So there were a lot of factors that helped that the breweries contributed to in the 1800s. Now the other one is, I have a lot of pictures with maps in them, and I didn't really know much about what this thing called the race was until about 4 years ago. And what the race was it was actually in downtown on the Rock River here. And if you look just to the left of Ford's Mill, it was really just a exit point for water to go around a peninsula that could be used to power different equipment, usually mills of some sorts, so they wouldn't have to use it as a source of power. And this bridge here would actually be the Centerway Bridge today. And this is, I think, was taken actually off of the railroad bridge just north of it. Here's a better picture. It's a drawing of it, and this was from 1877, but it gives you a really good view of what the race looked like. And the longer the race was there, the more built up it became. And by just prior to Prohibition, there were a number of buildings covering the race, and not much of it was really open. And here's a photo from 1961. The last major company that was there was Blodgett, the mills there. And when they finally sold out to the city, that's when they went ahead and actually filled in the race. And I was reading an article in the Gazette that said that they actually used the dirt from the public works area just north of Memorial Bridge is where they actually got the dirt from to fill in the race. So, but you can see, you really can't see much water here at all. And it would come out just north of the Milwaukee Street Bridge. So now we're gone through the background information, we'll actually jump into the breweries here. This is an interesting photo, and it kind of underscores the challenges with researching, because there's a lot of pictures that are out there, and they'll give a title of, this is a saloon, in this case the City Beer Hall. And as a researcher, you look at it and you're like, oh, this is interesting, but you frequently miss things. And sometimes you have to look at a picture four or five times, because this particular picture shows, I'll try the laser one here rather than, right here is a poster for Knips, and it has a goat on it, meaning it was probably for a Bock beer in the fall months. And then just over up here is a sign, it's hard to read, but it says Louis F. Knip lager beer. So this bar clearly received their beer from the Knip Brewery, which again, that would be the one behind Mercy Hospital. If you put all the brewery locations on a map, this is what it kind of looked like. If you see number two or number four, that means it burned down, so it had to be rebuilt. So the north side burned one, so there were two there, and there were four on the south side. So the first brewery that I can find documentation on was built by William Hodson, and he actually came over from England, a place called Cambridgeshire. And one of the fascinating things with the internet today is every now and again, someone will reach out to you from another country and say, oh, hey, I'm doing some research here, and I have some information on someone. And that was the case with Mr. Hodson. I know the Historical Society is going to be doing some a piece on Mr. Hodson, so I don't want to steal too much of their thunder. But before he came over in the late 1840s, early 1850s, he was a true socialist and tried building a socialist community in Cambridgeshire. And he was kind of a 1960s kind of guy. He was a big free love person. And he kind of ended up leaving England, not under the best of circumstances, but he came over here and reinvented himself. And he built the first brewery down on what would be Peace Court and Main Street. Not only was it Janesville's first major brewery, it was also the first major fire in the city of Janesville, because 3.5 years later it burned down. The brewery was completely destroyed. His house wasn't damaged too much. And he also, Mr. Hodson will be around for a while, because he'll open up a second brewery shortly, about 15 years later, 20 years later. But he also had a flouring mill, and he was pretty well off financially. Now, if you're looking for the location of where it would be, this is what the image kind of looks like today, if you're looking at it courtesy of Google Maps. And the brewery would be about in that area there. The warehouse here to the, get this right here, right there, Doty Manufacturing Company, and you can still see pictures of that in some of the early 1900s. That structure is still almost exactly the same as it was then. But the brewery would be in that general area. And then if you go ahead and you layer in what it would have looked like kind of with the race there, it would look something like that. So you have the peninsula, the electric facility is right here. That had been there for, was present throughout Janesville's history, for most of the history. And here's a couple articles from the Gazette. I try to tell a little bit of a story about each brewery or brewer to try to personalize it a bit. And the first ad I was able to find was one for Cooper's, the guys to build the barrels to put the beer in. And it's kind of interesting because when you start from the 1850s, by the 1870s, when you look in the city directory, you know, there's 25, 30 Cooper's. But then when you get around the turn of the century, when bottling starts, suddenly you're down to two or three, and then there are none. So it just shows how the industry can change over time. The second one was wanted barley for malting. And the last one is the article that actually talked about the brewery burning down. Not sure, there's a lot of, it's not always clear what happened after the fire. It may have been rebuilt, could have been rebuilt under a different name, I'm not sure, but that's one of these mysteries I'm trying to solve. The next one is Jacob Singer. Now he's located just, I would say, further up Main Street than where the ice arena exists today. Not a lot on him. We do know he got in some financial trouble and he didn't last too long. No advertisements. The only time he had his name in the paper was when he was in trouble with the law. There's a general area of where he would have been. Again, you got the ice arena right here. And we were able to find out this area because when they have the articles that talk about him getting in legal trouble, it actually listed out the lots of where the property was. So, again, everything about him in the paper is usually because he's in financial trouble. So that was the second one there. Now this is where things start to get confusing because there's two brothers, Alfred and I think it was William Bunster. Alfred was the one who was heavily involved in the liquor stores and the brewing side. But like so many other people, he ran into a lot of financial difficulties. Now, this, based on what I'm finding out in the city directory, this has this right across, right off of Walt, I'm going to make sure I get my street right here. You can see in the map here on the right, you have the Milwaukee Street Bridge right here, so he's a block and a half up. I believe that's about where he was. Again, sometimes when the streets get renumbered, they change and you have to be able to trace them backwards to find out when was it numbered that and were the streets renumbered since then. But this is a excellent picture. Sometimes in the city maps and around the edges, they would do sketches of buildings. And this is where I was able to locate this one here. I think it was an 1868 map. And it shows a couple different things. One is a building which appears to be some type of sales office. And you actually see some barrels out front there, which suggests that they're actually selling beer out of there. So A.W. Bunster, him and his brother, they own some lots of property, some up by Center Way, just to the, I would say, on the west side of Center Way. But they kept running into financial problems. And suddenly they would pick up shop and move. And he was able to run this brewery here for about a year and a half, 2 years. The brewery itself lasted there from 1857 to 1863, but he only operated it for a short time. Because in 1857, Lill and DeVersey, they were one of the biggest brewers out of Chicago, in that part of the entire United States. And they actually purchased the property from him when he opened up his second liquor store / brewery. And unfortunately, the Lill and DeVersey, when the Chicago fire hit, that pretty much wiped them out. So then the brewery changed hands a third time to Samuel Hocking. We have some documentation on him as far as being able to sell the beer at the site, but we're not really sure what became of the brewery at the end, because you don't always find out, you know, the building was necessarily torn down or anything destroyed. It's only what you have available in the Janesville Gazette, which is a great source. So as far as the location of his East Side Brewery, if you look here, this is where, let me get my map here, this would be the sporting goods store is what I remember it as here. You got Main Street running here, you got the Fireman's Park. So the location of that brewery would be in about that area, give or take. And if you added in the race, what it looked like back at the time in the old streets, the way they were named, North First and North Second, you could see, kind of get a feel for what it looked like. And here's some articles from it. The only time you see Bunster's mentioned as a brewery is in the first one, when Lill and DeVersey go ahead and purchase it, and they say, look, we've purchased this brewery. But everyone else just makes general reference. Even Mr. Hocking there at the end, he talks of a new brewery. But not a lot of details, no advertisements for it. Locally brewed beer, just the Chicago ones. And you look in the city directory, is a good example of how information can sometimes be very difficult to discern. Is you have, on one hand, you have Lill and DeVersey on Main Street between First and Second, and then right below it, you've got Samuel Hocking, Main, First and Second. It's probably the same facility. If not, one's right next door to the other. I doubt that Lill and DeVersey actually brewed beer here. It just wouldn't make sense. So A.W. Bunster runs into some financial troubles, sells his brewery / liquor store, and what does he do? Goes across river and opens up another one. How he got the money for this, I don't know. This would be the Milwaukee Street Bridge right here, and this is actually the liquor store. What I find interesting about this picture is, as you look at the foundation, I mean, the river's right there. So you'd have to imagine that flooded on a regular basis. But really, it was a forerunner of a number of the businesses that would actually extend in over the river, sometimes right off of the bridge. So he opens up his second liquor store on the west side. Again, runs into financial difficulties. And he ends up selling it, it was about five years later, to a gentleman named John Govier. And the Govier Brewery, when they actually mention it in the articles, it actually says it's behind Bunster's. So we generally know where it's at. Again, he'd be actually on the race. Again, here's your Milwaukee Street. On the race, you got the water right here, and he'd be right just a little bit behind it. And another interesting thing is, doing a lot of this research, is the reference place is by just a name. They didn't have an address, known as the Big Mill. Well, you knew what the Big Mill was back in the 1860s, but trying to find out what the Big Mill is today is very challenging. So do a lot of sleuthing work to try to make sure it's as close to accurate as possible. Here's actually a photo of it from the book the Historical Society had put together on it. You can actually see the front part of it. But so this would be looking down Milwaukee Street, looking to the west. It's got the bridge right here. And you can see Bunster's there, and of course, the local gun shop right next to it. And if you kind of took a look at the layout was at the time, again, I think the brewery was actually behind the actual liquor store, which would have been here. But you had plenty of stores up in this area here. I think there was a post office there at one time as well. Post office moved around, of course, as the city got bigger. And here's the articles talking about mainly his liquor store. Again, the only reference to the actual brewery at that location was from Govier and Harvey. the foreclosure of the Excelsior Mill is kind of an indication of the problems that Mr. Bunster was having financially. It's like everything he opened up. And the interesting thing about the Bunsters is just one day, they just disappeared. You don't see any reference of them in the Gazette. You don't see any reference in the city directories. They just leave. Maybe they were run out of town. And then Mr. Hodson, the gentleman who opened up the first brewery, he makes another appearance. And this is looking down again on Main Street, kind of in the same place as Bunster's Eastside Brewery. This is the Empire Hotel. And this is looking down Main Street to the, it would be the west. Is that right? No. North. North. No. Yes, north. And the best as I've been able to figure, its location would be in the area, again, very similar, close to where the fire station park is located at, in that general area. When he opened up the second brewery, he did so using his daughter's name. He just pretty much fronted the money. And because another one of the concerns or issues that Mr. Hodson ran into was he did not like to pay taxes. And there is a number of articles in the Gazette where his case went all the way to the Wisconsin Supreme Court, where he's eventually found not guilty. But he was not for taxes at all. He kind of made a stand, and in his case, he fortunately won. He ended up buying some property out in Turtleville, and he had a very nice house. It was there's a lot of a couple of nice sketches of it, and it was a very eloquent house. But of course, over the years, it's fallen into disrepair, and I don't think there's too much of it left now.
Where's Turtleville?
Okay, Chopier, is it kind of near Chopier? Yes. I'm lucky I knew that answer. Again, this is the general area where he would be, where it was located, using today's markers. And one of the things also, a pattern you detect when you're doing a lot of this research is, as soon as they're asking for a partner, you know they're in trouble. And sure enough, he only lasted about a year and a half before he actually ended up selling it. They were actually had a company out of Chicago come up and take a look at it. They were considering buying it and brewing beer out of there, but that seemed to have fallen through. Hemmings Saloon Brewery. This one was actually on West Milwaukee Street. It was in one of the buildings here. I got a good comparison picture here in a second. From pretty much the same angle as the original was taken in the 1800s. You had this gentleman, William Hemming. He owned a saloon, so he decided to open up a brewery in the back, and it was very successful. And after 2 years, he went ahead and built the more, perhaps better known, Hemmings Ale Brewery, which is today right across from the police station. Here's a picture, and based on, again, I'm using the numbers off the streets and trying to cross-check them in the city directory. This is I've been able to kind of narrow it down to this area right here, kind of where just a little bit to the right of where Mantiques is at, that store today. So if you take a look at the picture from this time frame and compare it to today, another interesting thing about it is when you look at the tops of the buildings, they're all the same except for this one right here. And I'll go back here. You can see how that one there had a very pronounced top. I don't know what the correct term would be, but that's really the only thing that's changed. The flat top right here in this building is there and the round one here and there. So it's 100 plus years, it's still largely the same. And there's a good reference in there about him opening up the saloon brewery and then his plans to go ahead and build the larger Hemming Brewery across from the police station. This is that, one of the few photos I have of the actual brewery. It stayed in operation until 1940. It changed hands a couple times. And technically, it was the last brewery operating in Janesville. The catch there, though, and the reason I say technically is they didn't brew beer out of there after Prohibition. They actually had their beer brewed by another brewery out of Two Rivers, Wisconsin. And one of the gentlemen in the bottling club had shown me the label. It says Esser's Ale, but if you read the fine print, it said brewed for Esser's by the Two Rivers Bottling Company, or Brewing Company. One of the things that kept him successful, though, when it came to brewing, is he did a lot more than just beer. He did a lot of spirits as well. And when Prohibition hit, they actually went, it was another owner, but they transitioned over to soda, and they were able to continue that to stay in business. I don't have a lot of information on Mr. Hemming. I know, unfortunately, he had a son. The brewery was renamed several times. It started off as William Hemming, then it was William Hemming and Sons, then went back to William Hemming and Son. One of his sons, unfortunately, drowned near Crystal Springs, which, and I have it in a later picture, it's just north of Riverside Park where the river bends. That was the area, because one of the big things to do back then when you wanted for entertainment is they'd frequently get boats and run people up to that area, as well as Riverside Park, and there was a couple areas, and they would just have parties. And then as the evening wore down, they'd get back on the boat and come back into town. So he was up there swimming, and we unfortunately passed. And I have no doubt that perhaps influenced his decision to eventually get out of the brewing industry, because wasn't able to pass it down to him. Now, the map picture here, the Wisconsin Historical Society has online, they're called Sanborn Fire Insurance Maps. And they are just a great source of information. They show very detailed information on each building, what it was made of, any equipment that was in there, like engines, how it was heated, or any electricity that was running to it. Because if there was ever a claim, they wanted to be able to go back and verify that. So that's a great source. I'd encourage you, if you're ever interested in learning more about some of the actual buildings in downtown Janesville, to check with that. These are some photos, again, from the Fireman's Souvenir album that they have copies of it in the Janesville room, which is where I spend most of my time when I'm here. These actually show the cellar. And when the brewery was first built in 1880, it was larger, and it was considered to be modern. But of course, as time moves on, there was a lot of technological development in brewing, and it quickly became outdated. Here's some examples. They have many of the problems we're confronted with today as business or homeowners existed back then. They would suffer from frozen pipes. And one time it actually, when they thawed it, they froze and they actually burst and flooded out his saloon. Another time they were trying to thaw out the frozen pipes using some boiling water and an employee got injured by it. Mm-hmm. So burglaries happened, a lot of thefts. Fortunately, they didn't get away with too much in this case in 1912. The ice harvest was a very big yearly tradition, and of course the brewers relied on that to help keep their beverages cool for longer periods of time. A lot of brewers, of course, would dig caverns to store the beer at a relatively constant temperature. But without the ice, though, to get it up through the spring and the fall months, they would have a very difficult time keeping those lagers cool. They went ahead, I'm sure some of you may have heard of Esser's Brewing out of Cross Plains. They're just west of Madison. They started brewing beer, I want to say it was in the early 1850s, and George Esser, who actually purchased the Hemming Brewery in Janesville. He was part of the Esser family, and they stopped brewing beer, though, in 1910, and they became more involved in distributing beer for Blatt's. And I think they just resumed it, according to their website, not too long ago. Was it 1995? And then I also believe they were just sold that brewery to Black River, to a company out of Black River Falls. But for some reason, George Esser left and came to Janesville. He purchased the Hemming Brewery, and he operated until 1921, when, again, Prohibition is in, and that's when the Heibel Company purchased it, and that's when, of course, they switched over to brewing soda to stay competitive, keep income flowing in. And he actually lived until 1942, and there's a picture of his house up there on Peace Court where he actually lived.
His house is to the right.
Oh, it is? I'm off one?
That's my grandfather, yeah.
Oh,
That
was the one from the Historical Society. They had listed the Historical Society page listed that as his house. As far as the articles that talking about Esser's, there's the one that mentions him buying Hemming's Brewery. He had to go back up to Cross Plains to attend his father's funeral when he passed. And George was very active in the community, as were many brewers of the time. And he was actually named head of the Eagles Club. The location of his brewery, again, we'll get our bearings straight here. You got the river right here. The police department is here. And the location of the brewery would be right about smack dab in the middle of those apartments. And the race, of course, was flowing through. You also had a train track. That's what the yellow is right through here. And the reason part of this here is in brown is because as the years passed, it became more and more built up with buildings over it, different. Try to take advantage of the real estate that was there. This is an interesting one, too, because I never would have guessed there would have been a brewery here in this location. It was Todd's Ale Brewery. And again, you're looking at a picture of the Milwaukee Street Bridge right here. This little building right here, which is now a parking lot when you pull in the park behind there, there was actually a brewery there. It was a very successful brewery, one of the most successful ale breweries in Wisconsin. And again, it's always interesting to see in some of these pictures. You get a better shot here at the Blodgett Mills right here. And of course, the buildings on over the Rock River. This is a picture that's actually quite common. It's looking up Milwaukee Street, and you got Peter Myers' house up top there. But if you look in the corner, you can actually see signs for Todd's Celebrated Ale is what he marketed. Now, John operated it. He started with a liquor store. Then he went into the brewing business and was very successful. So successful, he passed it on to his son. And he went ahead and started doing a lot of traveling around the U.S. He was able to keep it in the family until around 1890 when they had to sell it to two gentlemen by the name of Matt Fardy and Norton B. Robinson. And they continued to operate it out of the same location. But eventually, I think it was 1898, Mr. Robinson moved from that facility to a new one located just by Jackson Street, which we'll talk about here in a second. Here's a close-up of the Sanborn fire insurance maps, and it actually shows some locations where you actually have like the mash tubs, brew kettle. You can see it's a very narrow store. You have a very small alley you could walk through, and there were lots of buildings in the back. And I think over time, the building grew a bit longer. They kept adding on. It was still around in the 1940s. I saw a picture of it. There was, a fire on the bridge. And although the building was charred, it was still standing. There's a number of references of the brewery throughout the Janesville Gazette. Another interesting thing about beer is it was frequently marketed as a cure-all for anything that ails you, everything from mothers with their young babies to men. So, and every brewer that sold it, it was always the most pure, it was always the best, you'd always be guaranteed. So. And here's where they mentioned in, 1877, he was the largest ale brewery in the state of Wisconsin, which I'm sure made Mr. Hemming a little sad because he was his competitor, but. And then they were sold here to Mr. Fardy and Mr. Robinson. And here's a picture, and this is kind of a shame because N.B. Robinson built this facility right, it's in between the Jackson Street Bridge and the railroad bridge. It's actually closer to the railroad bridge. It's a beautiful building, as you can see. It's brand new. It was only in existence for 10 years, because as we'll find out, Mr. Robinson came into some money, and quickly brewing became something he wasn't interested in anymore. But this is another rare photo. We actually have a couple people in the photo with a loaded wagon. So the brewery is built just off of Riverside Street, and you can actually see in this picture here, or the map image, you actually have the railroad running right next to it. And in 1902, because he was very successful in the ale brewing, he actually ended up going to Texas. And the brewery started changing hands, but you could tell it wasn't going to last too long. They had a new manager. They wanted to add a bottling facility. I read several articles where they mentioned they were actually doing some bottling out of Milwaukee, which is kind of odd when you figure how far Milwaukee is away. But by 1904, they were looking to sell and unload it. And it essentially went for taxes for $50. And the building became abandoned. People would come in and steal stuff. And eventually, a short time later, I should say, it was just torn down. By 1915 Sanborn map, it's gone. Now here's a photo. I don't have the date of the photo, but I know it's no earlier than 1884. If you look at the corner, here's where the Rock River bends towards Monterey. That's not the brewery itself, but that's right about where it would be. And because there's no train tracks coming across there, you know it's earlier than 1884. And then we already spoke about the Singer Brewery over here on just north of on Main Street there, the southern portion of Main Street, excuse me. And we have yet to talk about the south side, but that was in this area here. So you really had three different breweries in that same area. It also shows, it's always kind of neat to see how the terrain, how steep some of these hills were in that area as well. This is the actual location of where the brewery was. I actually met the gentleman there when I was here back in May. And he knew there used to be a brewery there. He said his dad would tell him stories about it. But the garage, he said, is actually built on the same area where the actual brewery was. And now it's the railroad track has since become a footpath for joggers and bikers to come through. And there's some articles about the N.B. Robinson. What's interesting is the John Gunn Brewing Company, they're out of La Crosse. They actually had a depot in Marling Lumber Company, which I'll cover here towards the end. And N.B. Robinson was actually the agent for Gunn down there in Janesville. So there was a lot of working together between brewers. They had a storm that blew over their smokestacks in 1902, so they had to put up a new one. Again, 1902, the company increased in value by $20,000. They were doing very well. It's just that he had more money from other sources, so he just decided to kind of walk away from it. And then the saddest of all is when they sold it for $50 there. I mean, heck, I'd pay for that. Now, we're going to talk about the Southside breweries, and there were four of them. And this is one of the more fascinating ones because there's nothing left of them except the bottling house. But as I'm reading through a lot of the Gazettes, you learn about the Springbrook area, and it was considered to be kind of a retreat at the time where people would go to relax, to get away from it, as opposed to having to take a boat all the way up to Crystal Springs. And this is what it looks like today. Obviously, you got the creek going through, or the brook, excuse me. And it, of course, has changed quite a bit from what it used to be in the 1850s. And the biggest advertising advantage the breweries had on the south side, they could tap directly into that spring, spring water, fresh spring water, and they would advertise it frequently as such. This image here is from a 1937 aerial photograph, and it shows what things looked like back then. Now, the four breweries we're going to talk about were in this triangle point right here. For reference, the ice arena would be in this area here. You can see the gravel pits are already filled in with water there. And you got this area here before Dawson Field was erected or built. And then you also had, I think, lots of farmland here. And the train track is right here. There was a little a building there that would use to test streetcars for a while there as well. What's interesting here as well, as you can see, you can tell the way the brook was running because you can tell by the way that the water's coming out. And keeping in mind, back then, not 1937, but in the 1800s, everything got dumped into the river. Everything. So the first one goes back to 1856, and it's kind of sketchy, a couple different names. Marsh and Wagoner are the two gentlemen that opened up the first one. They called it several different things, but it didn't seem to prosper too well until a gentleman from Pennsylvania named John Rothinger came in, and he turned it into a pretty successful brewery. Unfortunately, he died at a relatively young age. He's only 56. He went up to Madison to attend some type of event, and he caught a cold up there, and he kind of lingered for 3 weeks before he finally passed. But what's impressive about Mr. Rothinger here is, again, you know, his brewery burned down on him twice, and even though he had only limited insurance, he was able to find enough money to go ahead and rebuild it and reopen it, each time bigger and better. He would brew for a total of 18 years, and this the best picture I have so far of what that original brewery looked like. It'd be very, very small, just a couple of buildings. And again, a lot of hard work would be going into the brewing process here. You didn't have conveyor belts and all these other things to make it easy for you. Again, the buildings back then caught fire. And if you notice where he's at, he's in the south side of Main Street. You know, the fire department's going to take a while to get there. A, you got to notify him. B, you got to get him down there. And by then, it was far too late. So the first brewery was destroyed in 1865 in a fire. And as far as where it was located, the significant building here is going to be this one here. It's the Globe Sheet Metal building today, and I'll talk a little bit more why that's significant here. But is it more than likely right across the street from it? And if you can kind of see how you get the lay for the land, how it kind of slopes up and down, and it slowly rolls down to the Spring Brook, but this would have been about where it's at. And an interesting story, I was speaking with Mr. Arndt, the owner of Globe Sheet Metal, and he was telling me in 2014 about, he noticed one day there were a bunch of city workers in this area, right in this area here. And he said a hole of some sort seemed to open up. And they actually lowered some city workers in there, and it turns out there was a cavern had opened up. Well, a lot of the cellars and even tunnels that were used to store beer had obviously given away, and he said they ended up dumping close to 3 dump truck loads of gravel in there to fill it up. So it's interesting stories like that that kind of help to put it into context. But the first brewery, I doubt they had too many tunnels, those and the caverns, they would come later on. Again, not much on it. This is kind of interesting. We already talked about Mr. Singer, and we're talking about Mr. Rothinger as well. But all four of them were guilty or had some property relationships and that were foreclosed upon. So there were some other relationships there that they had between them. The second one, and this is a great picture of the second iteration of the Southside Brewery after the first one was burned. Same general location right across from the sheet metal shop today. And you can see it's pretty big. And at this time it was called the Janesville Steam Brewery. Now this is, again, if you're standing on Beloit Avenue, the front of the building would actually be on the other side over here. And you don't, because it doesn't have the background, you don't see the gravel pits. It kind of looks like it's on its own, but there's actually the gravel pits were just behind it. Again, as I mentioned earlier, I'm not really sure how he got the money together to rebuild, but he did. And he immediately ran into financial troubles with taxes, of course, battles with the city over what he owed. Selling liquor without a license, selling directly to the public, selling after hours would quickly land people in trouble, and a number of the brewers that happened with them. And as luck would have it, by 1872, another fire hits and completely destroys it. Now, what's interesting here is this map here, it's from the 1860s. The brewery, I've got to get my bearings straight here, should be right here, but if you notice, there's nothing there depicting it. It was there, it's just not on this copy of the map. So you see a nice big ad in the middle talking about his brewery and the great beer that he makes from it. Mentioned the liquor license hearing that he had and selling without a license. Again, some of the same problems you see here today we run into. Now the third iteration, what's different about this building, it looks to be pretty much the same. You got the same central structure in this building here. All this appears to be new in this bottom part as well. So it looks like when they rebuilt it, this is just from a small sketch in an advertisement for it. Rothinger was able to keep it in his family shortly after he passed away. I believe his wife was running it. However, she had to sell in 1880 to William Marshall, who was here and there in other breweries as well, made an appearance. He sells it after 2 years, and by this time, the whole area down there is rather seedy. There's a lot of crime, robbery, a lot of, the city drunks hang out down there, and it's no longer the retreat area that it was decades before. So Mr. Kramer was the last owner for it, burned down the third time. He got busted for illegal voting, which, in the election environment of today, you'd hear a lot about. He didn't have any insurance. I think the worst part is, the brewery cost $4,000, but he lost $1,000 worth of beer. Now, if you try to imagine how much beer $1,000 was, back then, that's definitely something to cry over. And here's the article. It's a very nice obituary from Mr. Rothinger there. It talked about his contribution. And you see some of the ads from the city directories for the other brewers, the Springbrook Brewery, William Marshall, Nicholas Kramer. And the article talks about it being gone to ashes when it was destroyed in the fire. And that brings us to the fourth iteration. Now this building remained until the 1951-52 time frame when the city actually took it down. I was able to find out that they repurposed a lot of the wood that was in the building to build another city structure. So the brewing stops in 1920, but the building remained until 1950. And again, this is the backside of it. Again, if you're looking kind of from the Globe sheet metal shop over, I have yet to see a picture of the brewery from the front. And you can always tell it's the back because they would do a lot of the horse carts would come out here, the wagons would come out here. And I'm still learning more and more about brewing in the 1800s, but one thing I do know is they always tried to leverage gravity. So when they would bring the supplies in to brew the beer, they would always start at the top, and then the finished product would come out at the bottom. And that's true of breweries today for the most part. Here's a good picture from the Sanborn map that shows not only the brewery itself right here in between, but South Main was extended down, and it shows a gravel company that was located right on the edge of the where the Lions Beach is today. And then you had this pond here. It changed shapes many times over the years, but the significance of that pond was John and Michael Buab, the owners, actually went ahead and were able to string lights around it. It was the first park with electricity, and it was called Electric Park. It was the first one. So John and Michael, John was 21 years, Michael's older than Michael, and he stopped brewing by 1898. So Michael had taken it over. The brewery had burned down. They completely went ahead and rebuilt it. I'm sure they used parts of the foundation. And fortunately, it never caught fire again. Michael ended up stopping around 1905. He wanted his son to take it over. But as with Mr. Hemming, his son suddenly passed away unexpectedly. And that kind of cast the future of the business into doubt. His wife ran it for a little while, but then she sold it to some gentleman out of Milwaukee that actually came from Germany. And they would rename it Badger State Brewing. This is one of the photos. This is something I'd seen on eBay for, I don't know, looking at it for 2 months before I finally realized what the heck it was. It's actually a photo of the brewery here to the right, but whereas all the other pictures I've shown so far are from if you're standing really on Beloit Street looking up, this is if you're on top, right next to the Lions Beach area before you get to the ice arena, and you're looking down. And you can see the pond there. It's changed shape quite a bit. But you can actually see the brewery building right here. This at one point was an ice house. This may have been the original bottling building, which was very small. And this appears to be the back of the brewery. But they would hold lots of dances there. It was a very social event. Social occasions were held there. And, you know, as you find out, even with the Croaks later on, the brewers were a very important part of society there, and they did a lot for the community. This is a photo of the Globe sheet metal shop, and this is the only remaining part of a brewery that's still around today. The original, this bottling house, it was this portion right here, was built in 1907. It was 20 feet by 60 feet, and it could put out 30,000 bottles a day, which is extremely impressive. This here was added on a short time later, within 4 years, by the Buabs. And this part here was done in the 1970s. This is a picture, again, from a gentleman from the bottle club up in Milwaukee shared. I don't know who the two folks are on the beer wagon. I'm hoping that one of them, they are Michael and John, the gentleman on the left looks a little bit older. I haven't been able to track down any of the Buab family to try to fill in some of the blanks for me. And I'm not even sure if you pronounce their last name Buab. I'm just taking a guess at it. But this photo was taken. This is where the folks in Growing Up Janesville were able to help out. It was taken where on Court Street, where the parking lot for the YMCA is right now on the backside. That church was raised in 1971 or 72, that time frame there. And there's a lot of good articles on this. Now we're getting, obviously, we're not quite as far back in time. So you can see that the Buabs purchased the property. They went ahead and they're going to rebuild the brewery. I mentioned some of the tunnels that they would dig. In this case here, the article in the middle, two men were actually digging out a tunnel to store beer, and it collapsed. One gentleman died. The other one was just lucky enough to get out beforehand. And this talks about a keg washing machine, the last one there on the right. It was electric, and it was adjustable, so they could wash the kegs a heck of a lot quicker. Because one thing it's important to know about the brewers, when bottling started and you had kegs, they wanted to make sure that all that property made its way back to the brewer because it was their property. And they didn't want other brewers stealing it. So they were. That's why you would see sometimes in beer bottles, and they would say, this bottle's not to be sold. Or they actually have the brewer's name on there, so there could be no question as to who actually owned it. And the same thing with the kegs. The Buabs as well got busted for selling beer directly to families without going through a third party. There's a 1907 article on the bottling plant that was put together. And then they actually, they own quite a bit of property. One of the areas that they would host parties at would be, it was called Buob's Grove. And it's actually located right across from Riverside Park, not quite as far down as where Crystal Springs was, but they would grow apples there. And again, in the days before you had the internet and all these fun things to do, they would have competitions and they would bring different fruits and vegetables they would grow. And the Buobs were known quite well for their delicious apples. The purchased the Hotel London, which I believe is where the London pub was. And the breweries often played softball between one another. In this case here, the Buobs lost to the Croaks. There's the article there about William unexpectedly passing, which again kind of threw the company into a bit of a disarray long term. And then they sold it to some gentleman out of Milwaukee. And this is another great example of where someone from the internet, a gentleman in Germany, his name was Wilhelm Mier, sent me an email and he said, "Hey, I'm related to Peter Mier and I've got some pictures. Would you like to have copies of them?" So he sent those over, and this is actually a picture of Peter and his wife, Josephine. They purchased a brewery in 1913, renamed it Badger State Brewing. It was actually a team of men, but he was the leader. They say in life, timing is everything, and I think in the case when he purchased the company, the timing just wasn't right. First, the Buobs had run a very successful business. They were very well known, and it was kind of difficult to do the transition there. You also had World War I was going on, and there was a certain degree of anti-German sentiment there. And he was only able to operate the brewery for about 3 or 4 years, and then suddenly they just disappeared. Here's another close-up picture of the actual Sanborn map that shows where the bottling house was in relation to the brewery. And you got you still had a Cooper shop right there. And here's that 1937 image blown up of where the brewery actually was. Again, the front would be right here. You can see the road coming down through here. You'd have the gravel folks would be right there. The pond looks quite different. And you had the other buildings that were part of the complex with the bottling house across the street. And the brewer actually lived, the Buobs and the Mears, the house right next to it came with the property, so they would raise their families right there as well. If you kind of did an overlay of where things were versus where they are today, you'd come up with something kind of like this. You got the Army National Guard complex right here. So the actual pond that they operated would be right where this road cuts through today. The original road that South Main ran down would have been the yellow line here, but that's now just a pathway. The photo of the postcard I showed you where it was taken from behind, I'm guessing that it was taken from probably somewhere right around here coming up this way. And you can see the bottling house is still there. And there's some articles there that talk about the new managers coming and taking it over. And they're asking, of course, right away for all the bottles and kegs to come back to the brewery. As the brewery fell into disrepair, people would break into it and again steal stuff out of it. And some of the financial troubles that they ran into, one of the malting companies had to take them to court to try to get them to pay up. But really, by the end of 1917, the end was already near. Not only due to the problems they were experiencing here, but Prohibition was right around the corner. And even the Croaks Brewery that was up behind Mercy Hospital, they stopped brewing around 1918. And that leads us to the last one, and perhaps the one that has actually a fair amount of remains today at the north side. This picture is taken in the early 1880s, and it's interesting to see how breweries change because the foundation is still there. You can still see a lot of it. The original brewery is in this area right here. You can always tell, you look for little details with the way the bricks were made. Different colors or textures, and I've actually been down there looking at all the different bricks that are there, and I've identified like 8 different kinds of bricks already, trying to find out. Some came from St. Louis, some from Texas, just trying to figure out. The original brewery, I'll talk about in a second, just to put it in context, was very small, no more than this area right here, and you would have houses right nearby. There were 2 houses. Now, as the brewery expanded, it would expand it to the left here. The dwellings would, of course, be raised and the brewery built upon. So if you took a snapshot of it today, it's kind of, there's a lot going on down there. You still have one train track running north to south. The trail, The paved trail actually runs right in front of it here. It kind of cuts over where residents used to be. You have the bottling house, which is on the right across from the open grass area. It's where the bottling house remains are today. They can still see the foundation for that. Excuse me. It has a lot of pipes and running out from underneath it. The brewery itself, this would be where the original one was, and it slowly expanded out over time to perhaps almost 4 or 5 times its original size. And then you have a dirt footpath that runs in this area right through here, and this is what we're trying to clean that out a bit so it doesn't look quite as scary to people. Because you do have kids hang out down there, and there's a lot of graffiti, so at first it looks rather daunting, but there's a lot of good history there that is just, I think, waiting to be shared. So the first one was built in 1859. The gentleman who appears to have fronted the money for it was Anson Rogers, and he actually became a future mayor in the city of Janesville. And he also served as on the city council as well. He made his money shipping grain in Illinois, came back, invested a lot in real estate with that, and it was originally called the Janesville City Brewery. Now, he went into business with John Buab, the older of the two brothers, and it was quite successful. Here's a number of articles that talk about it. I started off with the first one here about his brewery does burn down. It's a case of arson. There's a full article that talks about how it's about 2 or 3 in the morning, the house across the street hears a wagon and a horse come up. It suddenly stops. It's quiet. They hear it leave, and then about 6 minutes later, there's a fire. Well, they never found out who did it, but that's how the first Northside Brewery was actually destroyed. Now, Mr. Rogers owned the brewery throughout his life, and actually his will stipulated that it continued to be leased for 18 months after he passed, and then the money would be divided up. But it was operated by a number of different individuals, to include a gentleman by the name of Gesellschaft, I believe is the way you pronounce it, and the Knipp Brewery, which I think some people may remember them from the pizza parlor they operated down around the river. And then eventually it would go over to the Crokes, who would buy it outright. So here's the earliest Sanborn fire insurance map, which shows the brewery as it stood in 1885. Again, the original one would be even smaller than that. We've already spoken quite a bit about John and Michael Buab. This is where they first started working before they went down to the Southside Brewery to begin there. And if I had to map out exactly where the original one was, it was made a little bit easier because all the cleaning out that happened here last week at the brewery site. You can actually walk up there now and clearly see where the kiln was. So I've been up there a number of times trying to make sense of it. I know it kind of looks weird. You got some guy standing there looking at pictures, and people are running by going, "What's this guy doing?" But trying to get everything marked. But if you start at the, you take a Sanborn map, you start with the most, the oldest one, and you can kind of just work your way from the kiln was here for the malting, then the original brewery, you see the windows from the original picture I showed when we transitioned here, and it just slowly builds its way out. This is taken from the bottom looking up. There's actually two paths that go down to the site. I wouldn't recommend taking the first one here because it is pretty slippery. But the second one is steep as well, but it's a little bit more navigable. The best way to go around is to actually walk around to that open grassy area and then come down the footpath. That way you won't have to worry about tripping or falling. So these are articles from the first Northside Brewery where they announced, Buab and Rogers announced that they are now producing beer. I'm not really sure how the buyout went of the property. Some say they went in together to purchase it. Others say that I'm not sure what the financial relationship was completely. I hope to get a hold of some of the tax records in the city to find out, flesh some of this out. You always had problems with runaway horses and beer wagons. Sometimes it actually collide and people would get hurt. And then there's the article talking about the fire, which fortunately didn't destroy everything, just a portion of the brewery. This is the map. I probably should have had this one in earlier. For reference purposes, this is behind Mercy Hospital today. This is Memorial Street Bridge. I'll never pronounce this right, Chautauqua Fairgrounds, which is kind of in that area there before Riverside Park. Crystal Springs, where they would frequently, the Croaks, we'll talk about here in a few minutes, they actually had a 5-year lease up there at Crystal Springs to host parties and dances for adults. John Buab actually found this out yesterday, where the place we grow those apples is actually right across here, right across from Riverside Park. There's a very nice house there today. The brewery was extremely successful. It kept growing, they sold more beer, they kept getting larger and larger, and a lot of that was due to the Knips. They became very well respected within the community. I'm not sure, though, what led the Buab brothers to walk away in 1882. I read a couple different accounts where they may have went somewhere else to build a new brewery, but they would come back, remember, to open up the Southside Brewery in 1884, 85 timeframe. So they finally, they initially leased it to the Knips, to Louis F. Knipp and Gesellschaft, but Gesellschaft, he transitioned out after a couple of years. He actually, I saw a picture of the Corn Exchange. His name is on one of the windows in the buildings in the Corn Exchange. It seemed like it was a type of a general store. But City Brewery, as I mentioned, expanded, and there's a number of different telltale signs. You can see, first off, everything in yellow here is stuff that they added to the building. They added the gabled roofs. They expanded the original portion of the brewery would be right here, I talked about, where they kept growing, and it would continue to grow more further. You can see the number of train tracks that were present there. The first train tracks weren't put in until close to the 1800s. So when that brewery was originally built, it was a very open area. You had the Tallman House, and that was about it. And you know, the whole beer brewing process was very, as I mentioned earlier, very smelly, and I'm sure the Tallmans weren't too happy that every day that they would have to open their windows and be able to smell the brewery. But as the city grew, they first put in one set of tracks, and then they expanded to another set. I think it was called the Edgerton Cut that would run out that way? And then they also had a coal and lumber yard that'd be just out of the picture right here. So a lot of industry came that way. And you'll notice that if you ever get an opportunity to go down there, and I'd encourage you to, the brewery, it's a very steep drop from the back of the brewery down to the river. Why would they pick that location to build a brewery? My thought would be, initially, one, it's a great area to build the day-out tunnels to store your beer. Two, at the time, it was in the middle of nowhere. And three, you got the river there, so you can throw all your stuff into the river without having to worry about hauling it away. So the Knips have taken it over. They increased production dramatically. One of the Knips, William, he left. He went down to Huntington, Indiana, and he brewed there with Hock and Knip just for a year or so. And then he left, and I believe he went over towards the Kansas area. And of course, you're going to see the same problems over and over as far as running afoul of the law. Illegally sold liquor, got a 30-day sentence. That's one of the few pictures I have of Louis Knip right here. And these are just ads, of course. It's a tonic, so it solves all the ailments, so you definitely want to buy it. And here's some of the articles. Politics, Gesellschaft appeared to be getting involved in politics, and they kind of held it against him that he operated a brewery. So that may have been one of the reasons he got out of it. There was actually a robbery at the brewery there. Fortunately, the safe was empty. They got inside it, but there was not much money there. And then that the ice harvest was a big event. Of course, the city would rally around it, and they would actually bring a lot of ice up to several ice houses they had at the Northside Brewery there. One of the gentlemen was working up in one of the higher areas of the brewery. He takes a step back, starts to go through the floor, injures himself. Fortunately, he wasn't killed. Of course, you have another runaway beer wagon, and then they sell it in 1904 to the Croak family, which I think of all the brewery items that are still around today, the Croak would be the most common, because when they declared bankruptcy in 1939, the equipment just went everywhere. So there's still a lot of cases, crates, a couple kegs here and there, and lots of bottles around. Here's a photo of the complex itself from the 1937 imagery again. You can see a number of interesting features on there. One of them, first thing you notice is you look over here and you got this kind of inlet of sorts. Well, that's all landfill now, and there's businesses there. You see just how big the brewery complex is. Got a train running through right here. And of course, the City Ice Company just across the river as well. Here's the coal company that operated there. The Croaks kept expanding, They were doing very well, but the threat of prohibition by 1918 forced them to consider alternatives to see if they were going to be able to perhaps brew near beer or switch over to ice. They just weren't really sure. They wanted to continue brewing, but as I'll have a couple articles to talk about here later on, they ran afoul of the feds and had to shut everything down. This was the last brewery in Janesville that actually brewed beer. Again, he closed and declared bankruptcy in 1939. I have no idea what happened to the building after they closed it. I know they raised it, but I don't know if they took away a lot of the bricks and reused them, because really only the foundation is still there today. I'm not sure what happened with a lot of the equipment that was there. My thought is probably a lot of it just went into the river. And I don't have a picture of the brewery head-on that's under the Croak name either. They're out there. I just have to try to get them. After Prohibition ended in 1933, they reorganized under the Bower City Beverage Company. They still sold Croak's beer, but it would say Bower City Beverage. So if you ever run across a label and you're trying to figure to date it, if it says Bower City Beverage, it's post-Prohibition. Here's a good picture of Frank Croak. He was very active in the community, just like the Bois brothers were. He was a big proponent of establishing the Janesville Fair. He did a lot of work to try to get Riverside Park established. He did a lot of fundraising for a number of different causes, and he even served on the police and fire commission, very active in his community. His house is actually right across from Washington Park. It's still standing there. Here's a good image from I want to say it's a 1915 Sanborn, the last time that they were produced. You can see the coal company here just below the tracks. You got a spur here and here. This is a dwelling. And again, if you go from left to right, you got the bottle house. I'm not sure what all these here are yet. I still have to do some more research on that. But you have these very large, and I have some pictures of what the site looks like today. But if you get the opportunity, again, I'd encourage you to go down there and take a look. It's pretty neat to see exactly how everything is laid out. There used to be an ice house right here. That stayed relatively constant throughout the brewery's life. And you can actually see there's a concrete foundation where the ice house used to be, just a little corner piece of it. So there's plenty of interesting stories of what happened down there in this area. The first one is a guy goes into work and it's 1905, he opens the door and he notices something isn't quite right, and the engine that was located just to the left of the door had fallen through. And to the best of my knowledge, it's still there. I think in the article they mentioned they're just gonna leave it because it's more trouble getting it out than it is to actually and just leaving it there. That area was a hangout for kids as well as a lot of homeless folks. And there were a lot of shacks that would go up there, little forts, you can call them there. And of course, when you got a lot of young kids running around, you always have problems there. Imagine that, a keg party thrown. I mean, even here we are in the 1914. The two articles on the left talk about the leasing of Crystal Springs to go ahead and actually shuttle people up there to hold social events. One of the dangers, I mean, obviously the river itself is very dangerous, but in the winter it would freeze over. But because they would dump a lot of their wastewater and other stuff into the river in the winter, the river never really quite froze where the brewery was located. And it was always thin ice, and a number of people had fallen through the ice. A couple of them had unfortunately passed. But the articles on the left talk about two men that actually drowned in the river and one who fell through the ice. The current is very swift on that side of the river, very swift. I find it funny that here you are in 1909, they have an article talking about the good old days, how it was like back in the 1870s and 80s. And I mentioned Mr. Croak and his fundraising. One of the things he did to raise a lot of money was held a button contest, and people would make these exquisite buttons and it raised a number of funds for them, for the city. And this kind of shows the back and forth of what the brewery was going to do when Prohibition hit. They weren't sure. Yep. In 1918, they stopped brewing, and then they say they're going to start again. They considered making ice for a while, but they changed their mind on that. They started making near beer, and then the feds came through and did an inspection and found the article on the right. They found a bunch of spoiled beverage. They shouldn't have had any beer on the premise at the time, and they did. And that pretty much put an end to any attempt to make any type of near beer. So if you look at it today, it's actually, courtesy of the Ice Age Trail folks here, it's a lot clearer today. A lot of these trees are gone. A lot of it, you can see the actual stone foundation. Now this would be, if you're standing right next to the river, looking to your right, this would be parts that the Knips added on in the late 1800s. And as you would go up this little hill here, you'd have the actual bottling house and then the open grassy area. This would be looking inside there's a very large rectangular foundation. And this is looking inside. You can actually see the supports for the beams that would run up to hold the floor, because the floor would come right across here. And if you look real closely, you can see some giant bolts that are embedded in concrete right here and here. And there's lots of little signs that these are, you know, of the activities and types of buildings that were there. Here's another shot where you have, unfortunately, a bit of graffiti there. But all the trees in the inside here have been cleaned out. And this is actually what appears to be a entrance into the cellar. This is what the bottling house looks like. You can see they got pipes running underneath here and an actual, I think, a large drainage pipe right there. And when you do research, sometimes the highs are high. When you put things together and you figure it out, you really feel ecstatic. But the lows can also be very low. And we were trying to figure out what this was, and somebody had mentioned, hey, maybe this setup right here, these four columns, maybe they were used to tie up people's horses because, you know, before you had automobiles. And so I was thinking, yeah, that actually makes kind of sense. And sometimes you think you're onto something there. Well, we were doing the cleanup there on Saturday. One of the gentlemen there who was involved with the Parks Department pointed out that he said, I know when those are built. He said, 74. I'm thinking 1874? He said, no. He said, 1974. So I was crushed. And he said one of the designers thought this would be a great spot for an area to overlook the Rock River, and he had him put in there. And he's also the same gentleman who was instrumental in getting a lot of the walkway installed for the trails. So that's and the last one, and I have to be upfront, I haven't done as much research on Grays as I have the other ones. I very much would like to get the opportunity to talk with them to find out more. But the focus of the briefing or the presentation is obviously on beer brewing, and there's some question, I think, back and forth as to how much beer they brewed when they started. I was just going off what American Breweries, which is kind of like the encyclopedia for all breweries in America, list them as, and they said they brewed a Weiss beer from 1903 to 1912. This is a very wheat beer, wheat type of beer. And this is a picture I'm sure most everyone has seen of the actual facility. Of course, it was founded by Joshua Gray, came from Ireland. And Charles Gray took it over after his passing. There's a couple bottles. A lady on the Facebook page about 6 months ago, her son found one of these bottles in the Rock River somewheres. And I was able to, because of the gentleman in the bottling club were able to help me out, they said, yeah, that was more than likely for one of their beer bottles. Because most of the Grace bottles are going to be soda or water, and they have these different types of, they're earlier, but different types of stoppers. Again, someone got an actual image here from one of their letterhead paper that they used from back in the day. And if you overlaid the complex looked like over what it is today, you could see, you know, the house is still here, but all this would have been the brewery complex there before they moved their location out to West Court Street. And a few articles there, they had some, in their residence there, some clothes happened to catch fire and they were able to put it out before it burned the house completely down. This speaks a lot about how well Charles Gray was thought of within the community of the bottlers. He was named the head of the Wisconsin Association of the Bottlers Association, head of the Wisconsin Bottlers Association in 1903. And here they are in 1904, talking a little brief history of the beginning of the brewery and where they stood. And Charles Gray happened to catch pneumonia in 1904. They said it was pretty serious, but he was able to recover, of course, and he went on to live quite a while after that. So that's it on the brewery front. I'm going to quickly go over three depots that I had no idea existed, especially the Gund one. But they were Blatz, Schlitz, and John Gund. A little bit of background information. I mean, obviously, the two of the three were out of Milwaukee. The Janesville branch for both of them was located on Wall Street. And here's a Google Earth map or image, and it shows, this is the storage warehouse, J&W Transfer Storage, I think. The Schlitz Depot was actually where one of their buildings reside right now. And Blatt's had two depots. The one in the light red actually was the first one that they tore down and built another one right along the rail. And some of the railway, a railway passenger terminal was right across from there. Excuse me. The Blatt's Depot, again, I got very lucky, and one of the gentlemen from the Bottle Club in Milwaukee was able to track down an actual letterhead of Blatt's from the Janesville location. And again, here's another ad you see where they're promoting it for mothers, you know, as a pick-me-up. I don't think you could do that today. And this is the 1937 map where I tried to overlay a lot of the roads to get an idea of it, because I remember, obviously I was born in the 60s and all this had been done. I remember one time my dad was trying to explain it to me and I just couldn't wrap my head around what it looked like. So the map kind of helps. Before Center Way, Wall Street extended all the way up, West Milwaukee and Court, which was called Pleasant at the time. And then you can see the location, the Schlitz Depot right here, Blatt's right along there, and the what's now the Wisconsin Wagon Company is there in the Chicago and Northwestern location there. The last depot that we have is John Gund, and they were out of La Crosse. I was able to go up there just a couple days ago. I was actually able to buy that keg that was in the back there from the company. It's a very heavy keg. It's a very old one. They had an extremely large complex in La Crosse. Never been there before. It's a very beautiful city. There's only a handful of buildings, I think three, that remain. They're turning one into a series of loft apartments. Very successful. They were one of the largest brewers outside of Milwaukee. The complex was extremely large. They had a massive fire in 1897, but they were fortunate in that they were able to rebuild it and brew even more beer. But like so many other ones, breweries at the time, Prohibition pretty much signaled the end of it. And that, interestingly enough, this is one of those things where I'm looking around and suddenly everything comes into focus. Remember we spoke about the N.B. Robinson Brewery, which would have been right here? Well, just further down that track there, Marling Lumber Company, you have this rectangular building, and that's pretty much exactly where the John Gunn Depot was located. I don't think they know that. And it also, there's also another interesting point here. Is if you notice this building at Marling, it's kind of cut off at a very weird angle. Well, the train tracks are long gone. And if you didn't know that it was angled like that to accommodate the tracks, that kind of explains why it's that kind of shape. So those are the breweries and the depots that I've been able to, with the help of many others, to piece information together on. So trying to come back to where we're at and where we hope to go. And continue researching the breweries. There's a lot more out there, a lot of records I still would like to go over and review. This is a several year long project. I really enjoy the interviews, sitting down with people and talking to them about the recollections or the family members. It's great because it's kind of happening like with the World War II veterans now, as they start to pass. When they're gone and the stories are gone. If you can't get them captured and documented, they're lost to time. So continue doing that. And working very hard to try to take the Northside Brewery site from something that's kind of an eyesore right now and turning it into something that actually offers back to the community. What's next for the actual research project? Well, I'm cobbling away on this website. You get a sneak preview over there. I'm hoping to get it up by July, so that way I can have a lot more information on there than just on the Facebook. I want to be able to explain in greater detail how the brewing process worked. Beer bottles are fascinating. I mean, trying to date them is a challenge, but more times than not, if there's any marks in the bottom of the bottle, you can find out who made it and the time frame that it was and where it came from. So we'll continue doing that, and who knows what's next. Sometimes you just go where this thing leads you. The interesting thing, though, and this is kind of my sales pitch for research in general, is there's a number of interesting things that are out there in the city that prior industries, you know, everything from railroads, ironworks, tractors, city ice, that if you can capture the information now and get it down and if you have a passion for that, just kind of follow it, because it is pretty cool. I have met more interesting people in the last 2 years than I did the 15 years before. Sometimes it can be a bit challenging or awkward, like when you go to meet somebody for the first time, and I go back to the Globe Sheet Metal. The first time I went there, I had to get my courage up to go in there and knock on the door, and Richard comes out, and I said, okay, my name is Rob, and I'm going to have a strange conversation with you. Just bear with me here. And as you start to explain the significance, people see, oh, I didn't know that. And then other things start to come into focus. And you meet people, and you make a lot of good friends, people I consider very good friends. So that's my sales pitch. If there's anything out there that you find interesting, but again, the highs are high, and the lows are low. Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate the opportunity to share this with you.